Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, I want you to praise him for a minute. Make some noise and tell somebody. Worship is my weapon, amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen, praise the Lord. You may be seated today in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen. It's good to be in the house of God today in the presence of the Lord. God is doing great things. Amen. How many knows that your God is a mountain-moving God? How many believe that today? Amen. I believe with all my heart there's some folk that come in here that need some mountains moved out of their life. But what you haven't realized is, see, God is a mountain mover, but what he said, you have to speak to the mountain. Amen. There's been some mountains speaking to you, and that mountain's been saying, I'm not going to move. I'm going to be what I always was, and I'm going to stop you the way I always did. But you got to make up in your mountain to say, be thou removed and cast into the depth of the sea. Amen. And the Bible says, amen, I'll put it in my terminology, that mountain will grow legs and walk off. Amen. Somebody say, move, mountain. Amen. It was to Zerubbabel, he said, amen, that mountain would be a molehill. Amen. You're fighting some things in your life. Amen. Some things are going on that seem great big. Amen. And the reason is, amen, that's what increases your faith. Did you know if you never face something that's really big, you'll never grow big faith? Problems must come your way. Situations and temptations have to come your way. And you got to learn how to stand up and say no to the devil and yes to Jesus. Amen. And you will grow in the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. So many people say, you know, I don't want that trouble. Amen. I don't want to go through that. But God says you don't go through it. You grow through it. Have you ever grew through something? Have you ever been in a situation that you didn't want to be in? And that situation ended up developing something in you that caused you to be a better person. Amen. Praise God. This is how God works on our character today. Amen. I want to preach a message. I won't be long, but I will be strong. Amen. Praise God. I want to preach a word today to you. Amen. Can you put my title up for me? Not Jesus only, but Jesus everything. Amen. Not Jesus only, but Jesus everything. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to go to Ephesians 2 and 19 to 21, and I'm going to read to you for just a moment this morning, but I'm going to be reading a lot of scripture, so you can stand if you want, amen, or you can just sit there and read however you want to do it. I have a lot of scripture, amen, probably won't get through a third of it, but that's okay, amen. Praise the Lord. When you're there, say amen. Ephesians 2, 19, 20, and 21. It says, now therefore you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and the members of the household of God. Now I want you to notice here, it said with the saints and the members of the household of God. Now for you that know anything about theology and know anything about today's terminology in the church, they continue to tell us that we're still sinners. I have not found, I found where we have all sinned. I have found where we were once sinners. But if you really study the terminology of the Word of God, amen, it talks more about becoming saints than it does you being a sinner. When I was a sinner, I was shooting dope and stealing cars. Come on, somebody. When I was a sinner, I was cussing people out and acting crazy. Amen. But when I became a saint of God, I still had that propensity, but something changed in me that if I did something like that, I repented and felt bad about it. Amen. God changed my heart. Took him a while to change me. And I don't know whether you know or not, he's still changing me. You don't believe me? Let me get up on the wrong side of the bed. I guess I'm the only one here that ever just got up, amen, and just got gripey for no reason, amen. Brother Chris, I guess I'm the only one that just chewed somebody out, just because I got up on the wrong side of the bed. But I want you to hear this, and I want you to, we have to have the ability to change the culture in which we're in. The truth is the culture's tried to change us. And so it says here that we are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built upon the foundation. Somebody say the foundation. Of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ, watch this, himself. He didn't send another person. Buddha couldn't do it. Muhammad couldn't do it. Come on, somebody. Self-righteousness couldn't do it. There's only one way to heaven. That's through Jesus. Amen. And the Bible says that Jesus Christ himself, being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fit together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. Somebody touch your heart right now. Touch your chest and say, I'm supposed to be a holy temple unto the Lord. Somebody say, that's what's been going on. That's why my mind's been changing. How many knows? Amen. Praise God. If you got saved and you ain't been changing, then something's happened. Amen. From the day till the day Jesus Christ comes back, God will be changing things inside of you. It doesn't matter if you're 80 years old, 90 years old, God's still working on you. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Causing us to be the holy temple. Amen. That grows together. That building. Amen. That holy temple of the Lord. Let us pray. Father, we bless your name. Thank you for your word. Ask you to have your way. God, help me to preach this message according to your word, your spirit of prophecy that's in this place. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Matthew 16, 16 through 19, I want to read this to you. Jesus had asked the disciples, who do people say I am? Some said Elijah, some said this, some said that. Then he said to Simon Peter, who do you say I am? Verse number 16, Simon Peter answered and said, you are Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. Now listen to this. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Amen. Jesus Christ, amen, spoke to Peter. And he said to Peter, up on this rock. What rock? Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Amen. It's a sad day when you have to come to a Christian church and preach about who Jesus is. Amen. Because in many denominations today, they are losing who Jesus really is. Amen. People are beginning to say, letting the New Age movement come into the church and say, well, there's many different paths to heaven. Amen. But I want you to know the Word of God tells me there's only one way to heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ. God gave his only Son. Come on, somebody, amen. God gave his only Son that you and I, amen, might make heaven our home. I would have no hope without Jesus. Amen. I told somebody the other day, I never seen a shirt that said Buddha saved me. I never seen a license plate that said Muhammad saves. Because that's all religion. It's not relationship. And I don't have a problem with pure religion undefiled before God. I think there ought to be religion in church. If there ain't, then there's no order. If there's no order, there's nothing but disorder. But I'm talking about Christian religion. I'm not talking about New Age mumbo jumbo crazy stuff. I'm not talking about, amen, the things that are trying to enter into the church. Amen, praise God. This isn't a magic wand that you wave. Just because you get saved doesn't mean everything gets better. Sometimes you get saved and all hell breaks loose. Sometimes you get saved and things really go crazy. Man, there'd be mornings I woke up thought, I don't even know if I want to preach that message, because then if I preach it, I got to live it, and it could get really crazy. Amen. I don't even know if I want to preach that strong today. Have you ever preached something that you struggled living? Have you ever read something that got inside of you and you knew it was the Word of God, but it fought with everything that was in you? Come on, somebody. We're real people today. Amen. Serving a living God that wants to change our lives forever. Jesus said to Peter, he said, upon this rock I will build. Now watch this. He said, it's my church. It's not some New Age spirit church. It's not the Methodist church. It's not the Baptist church. It's not the Pentecostal church. He said, it's his church. He said, upon this rock I'll build my church. And he said this, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I don't know what's fighting you in your life today, but I can tell you what's fighting for you. Amen. The Word of God stands up boldly and declares that hell will not have its way in your life. Amen. The Bible tells me that greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. You got power in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, I'll get back to my title here in a minute. 1 Corinthians 3:10 and 11. Listen to this. As Paul was writing to the church, he said, according to the grace of God, which was given to me, as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation. Hey, get back to your Bibles. It's okay to read books, but be careful. People are crazy nowadays. We're moving into a time where they want to push nothing, amen, praise God, but prosperity, and they want to push all this crazy. We need to get back to the basics of, come on, I'm telling you, you know, they preach these prosperity messages across America, but you can't preach it in Ukraine or in Africa. So if it can't be preached there, amen, it's not really the message of God, amen. I understand America has been prospered, but I seen the other day in Africa where little babies are dying of malnutrition. Amen. I'm telling you, amen, the gospel is Jesus. Jesus can be preached in Africa. Jesus can, I've watched it, amen, in Ukraine. We've watched them in broken down houses, in bomb shelters, preaching Jesus and baptizing people in the name of the Lord. Amen. The message doesn't change because of the atmosphere. The people in Ukraine, the preacher that was just at Pastor BJ's a few weeks ago, the prophet came to him and said, get your stuff and get out of here and take your family and go. He said, that man's low on faith. I ain't going anywhere. And he went home and God spoke to his heart in prayer. Said, get your stuff. Can't you just do what he said? Just get some food, get some money, and get ready. When it hit, he jumped in a car that he bought. He drove. He got his family out of Ukraine. And when he got there to where he was going, I can't remember the name of the city, but it was a safe place. He got there. He got his family out. He said, thank you, Lord. He was praying. He praising God, saving me from this mess in Ukraine. And God said, I got your family out, but you need to go back. And even to this day, he goes back and forth, and he's running a church in Ukraine in bombed buildings. That's the message of Jesus Christ. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. Come on. Bombs can't stop him. Come on. Amen. Putin can't stop him. Amen. That great bear, Russia. Come on, somebody. You're seeing it push back. Amen. It's trying with everything that it can. Amen. Come on, to chomp its teeth down into Ukraine. But come on. God is God. Amen. And God is going to block the way from Russia getting, amen, over to Israel. Amen. And if they did get there, they would be sorry they got there, because God said that nation will not be destroyed again. We're living in a time like we've never seen, and we have to know, amen, Jesus said this, upon this rock I will build my church. Brian Norman was with us, amen, a few weeks ago and showed us the picture in Israel where Jesus spoke that. At what they called the gates of hell, where they had taken babies in and sacrificed babies. He showed us the picture. And when Jesus said that, he was standing right there. He said, look, Peter, up on this rock, I'm going to build my church, and no false deity, no fake God. Come on. Amen. God is a jealous God. Amen. Will ever take my place. I will not share my glory with another. He said, up on this rock, that rock is Jesus. Somebody say Jesus. Somebody say Jesus. The late great brother Urshan was teaching on Jesus' name baptism when another denominational preacher said to him, you talk too much about Jesus. Can you believe that? A denominational preacher said, you talk too much about Jesus. Brother Urshan, with a kind of sarcastic grin on his face, looked back at the preacher and said, if I had 10,000 tongues, I would wag them all for Jesus. Amen. Come on. Amen. Not Jesus only, but Jesus everything. Somebody say, Pastor, where'd you get this message from? I'm glad you asked. Many years ago, when I was a young man, still young to some, old to others, amen, 30-some years ago, Jimmy Swaggart wrote a book, The Era of the Jesus-Only People. So there was this scuffle. How many knows there's been religious scuffles for so long? But he wrote this, The Era of Jesus-Only People. And he said they didn't believe in God, that they didn't believe in the Holy Ghost, they only believed in Jesus, which he didn't know what they believed. He just wrote what he thought. Then Benny Hinn wrote, Good Morning, Holy Spirit. How many ever read that book? It was a good old book. And later on, he said he was sorry for writing the book, because sometimes we just don't know what we think we know. But when Jimmy Swaggart wrote this book, The Era of Jesus Only People, amen, the era of Jesus only, there was a little lady that went down here, amen, to the United Pentecostal Church, and she was talking to a lady that was a part of this movement, amen, and I love to hear Jimmy Swaggart preach, man. He was one of the best of his day, amen, and I'm not knocking nobody. I'm just telling you what happened. They had a little argument, amen. A lot of Christians like to argue about stuff. They had a little argument, and Brother Ryan, she said, you know what, you're one of them Jesus-only people. And she looked back at her, she said, I ain't Jesus-only, I'm Jesus-everything. And that's where I got this message, amen. If I had 1,000 tongues, I would wag them all for Jesus, amen. How can you go wrong preaching the sweetest name that there ever was, amen. Go with me, amen, to Acts 4, 7, and 18. Amen, Acts 4, 7, and 18. Amen, praise the Lord. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have you done this? This is them asking the disciples. And Peter being, now watch this, I want you to catch this. Peter being filled with the Holy Ghost. It didn't say he was half full. Didn't say he was a quarter full. Have you ever been a quarter full? Come on, somebody, don't lie. Have you ever just had a trickle? I've met Pentecostals that only had a penny worth. Oh, it's quiet. They could shout. They could run. They couldn't live it. They could dance. They could even talk in tongues. Boy, but they could cuss like a sailor. Pentecostals. My God, it's quiet in this place today. 40 miles out to sea and hit a stump. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said to them, rulers and people, elders of Israel. If we this day are judged for the good deed we have done to this helpless man, and by what has made him well, let it be known to you all and to the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole. I want you to hear this right now. The Antichrist is among us. Somebody said, oh my God, don't nudge your neighbor. But listen to me. The Antichrist is here now. The Antichrist spirit has been here for years. And it's fighting the name of Jesus. They tell us at ball games you can pray, but you have to pray in the name of God or the Father. But you cannot. They told an army chaplain, they court-martialed him because he prayed in the name of Jesus, because it might be offensive. It might be offensive. The one that died on the cross, the one that was beaten and hung there naked for all mankind, has become offensive to the Muslim because the Muslim do not serve the Christian God. Too many people say, well, it's the same God. It's not the same God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believed in him would not perish but have everlasting life. That's the only real God that there is. Amen. And any other God beside him, Brother Cecil, is not a God at all. It's a little g, not a big g. Our God is spelled with capital G-O-D. Amen. He's God all by himself. But it's crazy that in this culture, in this church, that I have to take time today to preach to you Jesus. Because that's really why we're all here. Because of Jesus, I suppose. But so many other seducing spirits, the Bible said, and doctrines of devils. Perilous times. Men will heed to themselves, amen, their own ideas, tickling ears. Whisper sweet nothings and write me books on progress and blessings. But don't tell me how to live. Can I preach? Don't tell me that my kids have seen more murders on television than a Vietnam veteran that did 3 terms in Vietnam, 3 one-year terms in the middle of the hottest war that there was. Don't tell me that. Don't tell me that my kids are being desensitized by the garbage that they see to the point that death means nothing to them. Don't tell me that. Just tell me that I'm blessed and I'm favored and I'm good and I'm lovely and I'm kind, when the truth is you're a mess. When the truth without God, we're in turmoil, man. Without God, without the power of the Lord in our life, we are in trouble. Somebody hear me today. We need the power of God back in our lives. He said, amen, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I want you to listen to this. Amen. Verse number 11, it says, and this is the stone which was rejected by the builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Somebody say Jesus. I want you to, Jesus. Jesus. I'm going to show you something today. Amen. I'm not going to try to be politically correct because I'm not a politician. But I'm going to show you something. Say Jesus. No, say Jesus. Jesus. Say it again, Jesus. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. Say it one more time. Say Jesus. 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 Say Buddha. I'm just saying, say Buddha. You don't feel nothing. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. Jesus. Now, I pray for people that are wrapped in them religions. I pray for people that are bound by false doctrine. But I'm telling you that the power is in the name of Jesus. The Bible says that neither is there salvation in any other name, for there's one name given among men whereby we must be saved. Amen. Don't be deceived, but believe. Amen. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. I'm getting ready to slap some stuff around. Brother Gavin, you ready for this? Man, when Tinkerbell came along, Disney's been doing it for a long time. Tight little funky looking britches. I mean, it's hard to believe, but Tinkerbell invented them spandex pants that these crazy people are wearing. Don't get mad at me, but even fat people wear them. You think Tinkerbell ain't been, oh, it's quiet in here now. You think Tinkerbell ain't been preaching? Come up in them little tights. Now, almost every Disney movie you watch, you got a little girl kissing a little girl. Or a little boy. I went to the hospital the other day. They asked me if I was male, female, and how I was born. Oh, man. This is a hospital. Brother Mark, that's crazy. It's a hospital. Want to know what my gender was? Go back and look. I just looked at it. I thought, my God, I'm getting ready to get a sleep test. I won't sleep tonight. Were you born a male? Yeah. Are you still a male? Yeah. You ain't changed your mind? No. No. Well, I about feel like saying something, but I ain't gonna say it. I ain't gonna say it. It wouldn't sound right. If they ask you if your gender's changed, tell hell no. Tell hell no. Amen. Talk to your children and your grandchildren and get to them quick before the school does, because if you're not careful, they're going to be coming home all mixed up. Come on, somebody. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Now check this out. It says, this is the stone that was rejected by the builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. It says, nor is there salvation, verse number 12, in any other, for there's none other name given among men under heaven, given among men, whereby we must be saved. Somebody get this. There's only one name. There's no other way to be saved. And I'm going to read a couple things to you. Check this out. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, because see, Peter was filled with the Holy Ghost. He didn't just get him a little sip on Sunday. He was one of them Monday dudes. He's one of them dudes that the devil didn't want to mess with on Tuesday, because he would walk by and his shadow would touch somebody and they'd be sick and they'd get up and they'd walk off, because he was full of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Peter wouldn't walk around wondering if he's going to get rid of his Marlboros. He was full of the Holy Ghost. Quiet now. When they saw the boldness of Peter and John, perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men. They marveled. Now watch this. They marveled. I love this part. And they realized that they had been with Jesus. See, amen. They had been with Jesus. They marveled because they knew by the way they acted that they had been with Jesus. Stephen had been with Jesus, amen, when he gave his life, when they stoned him, and he said, don't hold this to their account. Somebody say he had been with Jesus. Read the words later on. Check it out. Go back and read on Stephen in the book of Acts, one of the first martyrs. Watch what it says. He was full of the Holy Ghost. And he shined like an angel. Amen. How many can imagine you're getting your bones broke, stones are hitting you, and you're shining like, you wouldn't be shining like an angel. You'd be cussing like a maniac. I'll be honest with you. My wife's got this crazy cat. Everybody sees it and says, what kind of cat is it? I said, it's a stupid cat. I say it when she's not around. They say, what kind of cat is that? I says, a short-haired Asian something. What is, Oriental. And I'm sitting in the room, and it just noticed I had toes. And it won't quit looking at my toes, and I move my toe, and I seen it. And it takes its paw, and it reaches out, and it touches my toe. I said, cat, you better stay away from me. Nah, I'm not no big cat lover. I'll just be honest with you. I have trouble. I could live without him, but I can't because I'm married to my wife. But it reaches down, touches my toe. And I said, cat, you better stay away from me. Get away from me. And I kind of looked the other way. Next thing I know, I move my toe. That cat looks at my toe again and puts his tall paw toward me like it's going to touch. I said, don't you touch me, cat. Because I know this cat. It's crazy. Brother Josh, out of nowhere, that thing reached out and took a bite of my big toe. It took all the Holy Ghost I had in me from kicking that thing right. You know, anybody know what I'm talking about? It may not be a cat, may be a person in your life, amen, that just sandpaper, sandpaper, sandpaper. Just say it. Sandpaper, sandpaper, sandpaper. Amen. Personalities, attitude, situations. Amen. Praise God. But they were ignorant and unlearned is what King James Version says. But they realized they had been with Jesus. Now watch this. And seeing the man who they had healed standing there with them, they couldn't say nothing against it. Somebody said a while back, I've heard this through the years, Pete Aldridge is getting high again. I said, you didn't know if I was getting high. One thing, I wouldn't be 250 pounds. We won't tell you the rest. People always throwing jabs, always throwing punches. My son ain't here this morning. He went and visited another church with his girlfriend. But I was down here working. We just got the church open, man, enjoying my new office. Just like freaking out, looking across the acres, thinking, oh my God, what are you going to do next? I get a text from him. He told me off. He said, here it is. I'm turning 18, my last year of school, and you're never home. I mean, it got me. Made me mad, made me sad. You know what I mean? I went home, and I just stayed home, and now he's been playing football ever since, and he's never home. So it's okay for me not to be home. I want you to feel this. The enemy will touch you where it hurts the most. He'll use whatever he can, because I know how much I failed with all my other children. I faced them failures. I brought them to the altar, and I repented. But when I feel like I'm doing the same thing again, it's not just something I did stupid. It's stupid me. The devil knows how to make me feel at my lowest point. He knows how to make you feel. He knows how to hit you. He knows how to weaken you. He knows how to depress you. Have you ever got up and just wished I could just stay in bed for the rest of my life? What I'm telling you, this is normal stuff, because as long as we're on this earth, we're going to be human. But not only are we human, we have opportunity to be filled with the Spirit of God. And it's the Spirit of God that will pick us up out of our bed when we can't get up. Amen. He will pick us up and give us the strength and the grace to carry on. Amen. I could not make it without Jesus. And friend, I don't know if you know it this morning, but I come to tell you, you could not either. It says, but when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves. Somebody say the demons are having a meeting, saying, what should we do to these men? For indeed, that a notable miracle had been done through them, it is evident to all who dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But so that it spreads no further among the people, watch this closely, let us severely threaten them that from now on they speak to no man in this name. That they speak to no man in this name. Listen, the battle is against the name of Jesus. The war is against the name of Jesus. The unified church that comes together will be a unified church of all different kind of Indian religions and Islamic religions, and that say we sat at one same table and we serve the same God. But I'm telling you, friend, you have to take a stand and say no, no, 1,000 times no. There is one Lord. There is one faith. There is one baptism. There is one God who is through all and in us all. Amen. And if it is not the God, come on, we have to believe in the virgin birth. Amen. Praise God. There are many writings, amen, and many other religions that will say that Jesus was a prophet. They'll say that Jesus was a good man, but they will not say that Jesus was the Son of God born of a virgin. Amen. And in this church, come on, somebody, in the Christian church, somebody say, Jesus, amen. He is Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God. Give him a great big praise today. Amen. Well, I'm about done here, but I got another scripture for you. 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. Now you can ask Brother Derek how many scriptures I have. This is about none of them. We'll carry this on later. I want you to get this. Moreover, brothers and sisters, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you. Now, I want you to notice this. And later on, I would read to you when Paul says, though an angel from heaven, a man or an angel from heaven come preaching any other gospel, let him be accursed. He never says gospels. There's not a gospels. There is a gospel. And it's important to figure out what the gospel is. The gospel is real simple. It's the life, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The gospel. You find the gospel in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts. If you read Luke and Acts together, that's called the Luke-Acts study, because it was Dr. Luke that wrote Luke and wrote Acts, and you'll have a better understanding of the gospel. Amen. Then you can go on and figure other stuff out. But until you got that, you don't have the foundation of the apostles, the prophet, Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone. You can't jump somewhere else and make a gospel out of Romans or someplace else. It explains further on the gospel, but the gospel is explained, amen, through, praise God, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts. Amen. Here in Corinthians, this is what he says. He says, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preach to you, which also you received, in it which you stand, and which also you are saved. Now watch this gospel saved. And if you hold fast to that word which I preach to you, unless you believe in vain. For I delivered it to you first of all, which I also receive, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried and he rose again on the third day according to the Scripture. This is the gospel. Somebody say, thank God for the gospel. Say it again. Thank God for the gospel. Amen. Let me roll this thing to a close. There's one body, one spirit. Just you're called into one hope and one calling. This is Ephesians 4, 4 through 24. It says there's one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in you all. But to each of you, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts to man. Now this, he ascended, what does it mean? But that he also first descended to the lower parts of the earth. He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill, somebody say this with me, all things. Say all things. And he himself gave to some apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, and for the edifying of the body of Christ. Amen. Somebody say that's the fivefold ministry. So that's why we got Brother Del Begley coming next week. Amen. Praise God. Fivefold ministry. Amen. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we, now watch, that we should no longer be children. I want you to get this. It takes the fivefold ministry. One man can't bring you everything you need. The fivefold ministry is not eliminated, but neither is it taught much about in the American church. We have the pastor, the prophet, the evangelist, the teacher, and what? Apostle. They're still active. They're still alive. We still have men as apostles going starting churches in other countries. We meet these people. We see them. Amen. Brother Del Begley operates as a evangelist, reaching the lost, and also operates sometimes in prophecy and the word of knowledge. We have seen him operate in mighty moves of God. But with all this, you can have all this, but if there's not a change in the people, then it ain't the fivefold ministry. If there's not a change, because it's for the perfecting of the saints. Listen, so he says this, verse number 14, he says that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro, carried with every wind of doctrine. So that means this wind is blowing across America, and prosperity messages and all these messages and all kinds of winds of doctrines. But he said, I don't want you to be children any longer. Somebody say, I want you to grow up. Grow up. He said that you be no longer children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things unto him who is the head, Christ. Man, if I could say anything to somebody struggling in addiction, you know what I'd say to him? Grow up. Talking to somebody struggling in a dysfunctional lifestyle, can't figure out how to pay your bills, amen. You can buy a pack of cigarettes, can't pay your light bill. I'd say grow up. Get your license on your car, cancel your insurance as soon as you get the license plates on there. I'd say grow up. Can't wait for that tax check and what is all that money they've given away a while back trying to break the country? Stimulus. Everybody's like, well, I'll get my stimulus check. People quit working over stimulus and they ain't went back yet. Crazy. Grow up. Learn how to work with your hands. It's okay to have a sore back. I told somebody the other day, somebody said, well, I got a cold. I said, well, go to work with a cold. If it ain't COVID, take a COVID test and go to work. Now it's getting really quiet. But my big toe hurts. I'm not going to go to work. Then who's going to pay your bills? Grow up. Grow up. Grow up. Grow up. Grow up. Grow up. Amen. He said, grow up, brother. Brother Dustin, Can I pick on you? Just grow up, man. Grow up in all things unto him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined, knit together by what every joint supplieth, according to the effecting work by which every part does its share. Let's stand. Causes growth in the body for the edifying itself in love. This I say therefore, and I testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk. Watch this. Please listen. No longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk, in the fertility or the dirtiness of their mind, having their understanding darkened and being alienated from the life of God. Grow up. Quit watching trash. Preacher can't come and be there. We ain't got enough people to watch all of you. Somebody said, I need a mentor. You have one. You have a brain. Horse sense, common knowledge, conviction of God. Sometimes your mentor won't be there, but God will always be there saying, don't do that. Start listening to God. Somebody say, grow up. Listen, having in their understand darkened, being alienated from the life of God. When your mind is messed up and you fight with God, you alienate yourself from God, and then you blame it on everybody else. I still haven't figured out, everybody that quit church blames the preacher. I don't get it. They blame somebody in the church instead of just saying, I was a dipstick and I quit. I went in a battle and I didn't see the battle. And I'm sorry. They burn bridges as they go instead of saying, you know what? It was as much me as anybody else, and I just want to be right with God. And I understand the church ain't perfect and the preacher ain't perfect, but God is perfect, and I'm in it for the long haul. Amen. Because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. I'm going to say this. This is a little old-fashioned, but it needs to be said. I asked somebody the other day, they're putting a little girl in the dance thing at school. I know they'll see this on Facebook, and they'll probably hear it everywhere. They're going to put their little girl in this dance thing, and they're going to teach her how to be immodest, really immodest. Put on tight shorts, skin-tight clothes. Sometimes a little bit of nothing. They put them in that. How are you ever going to pull them out and then show them what holiness is? When I say holiness, I'm not talking about long hair and long dress. I'm talking about modesty. How are you going to turn that around when you're sexualizing them? How will you get to the point where you can say, okay, now, honey, this is where we stop and we turn around. We don't do that no more. One of the most gross things that I've seen is when they was taking these little 6 and 8 year old girls and dressing them up and making them become like Miss America. But little painting their faces and putting wigs on them and putting all them clothes on them. And did you hear the horrible stuff that went on in their minds and their hearts? Who come up with that doctrine? It's the world. And somewhere we got to find a place where we say, you know what? No, we're just not going down that road. We're not ignorant to it anymore. Because our hearts aren't blind no more. Our hearts are not blind no more. Who being in the past filling have given themselves to lewdness, to all the works of uncleanness and greediness. Now listen what he says. But you have not so learned Christ. I was standing on a football field the other day, and I had some people sitting around me that was probably my age, some a little older, some a little younger. They did their little dance team thing. And I heard a grandma say, "Oh my God, I wouldn't want my kid out there shaking her hind end like that." But the world would look at her and say, "Oh lady, you're crazy. What's wrong with that?" Because we've been desensitized. We don't know what's right and what's wrong. How do we find the ways of God again? Except for through Jesus in a personal relationship where we say, "God." Somebody told me one time, if you're turning a ship, you have to turn it real wide. Because if a ship was to turn in an ail, it would just fall over. And some way all of us have to start turning the ship back toward God. Lest when he comes back and we're standing there and we say, "But we went to church every Sunday. I even taught Sunday school class and I was on a church board." He says, "But I never knew you." They said, "We prophesied and we did this and we did that." He said, "I never knew you. I was never intimate with you." It's one thing to know God, and it's another thing to be known of God. And it's in that quiet place where God talks to us. And he gives us the preciousness of who he is and helps us to turn that ship in the right direction. Amen. If we could just bow our heads today. As God speaks to your heart and your spirit. Listen for that small, still voice. It's not in a whirlwind right now. But just that voice of God that says, "This is what you could do different to make things better for you and for your family. This is what you could do different." I'm not going to be hard on you, but I can help you. Just listen to my voice. Stop going where you know you ought not to go. Get off the phone with people that are pulling you down. Stop hanging out where people are discouraging you instead of encouraging you in the Lord. Start hanging around people that lift you up instead of knock you down. Start walking in your house and say, "I am going to be the leader of my family, and I am going to show them the ways of God. And I may have started late, but not too late. Because with God, all things are possible." Father, we come in your presence on this Sunday morning, thanking you for the goodness and mercy of the Lord. We thank you for your word that is quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, able to pierce asunder the bone and the marrow, judging the intent of the heart, Father. We thank you that on this Sunday morning, even right now, there's open heart surgery taking place all over this congregation, people that are thinking and weighing things in the balance. I declare, Father God, that you are the great shepherd, the over-shepherd, the chief shepherd of this great people, that they belong to you. Father, I pray that you bless them, protect them, that you be with them in every area of their life. Help us, Lord. God, without you, we can do nothing. According to your scripture, it tells us, God, that you're the vine and we're the branches. So, Lord, do your work, and we'll give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. You're dismissed in the name of the Lord today. Amen. We love you very much. Amen. Please sign up for the pastor's appreciation dinner out there. Amen. God bless you.
in the morning when I arise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I am alone, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me die. When I come to die,